following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It's a Friday. Oh, we love it when we make it to a Friday. Another week in exile. Oh, quarantine. Home. You know, trying to stay safe and healthy in these crazy times. Hope you're doing well. Hope you survived this week of insanity. But thankfully, the Republican National Convention is done. It's history. It's over. Thank goodness. Wow. You know, I had every intention of watching last night. I did. Not because I'm a masochist, but because it's my job. I watch so you don't have to. I didn't get to see most of it live because I have sleep issues. And so I felt I was trying to stay awake. And I, just as, you know, I sat through Ivanka introducing Daddy. And saw him take the stage, and just all of a sudden, this feeling of fatigue came over me, and I thought, "Oh, I'll lie down and watch it." And I was out. I was out like a light. And I woke up as I usually do, somewhere around what time was it? You know, somewhere in the 2 a.m. area thereabouts. And yeah. And so turn on the TV and watch some of the coverage. I'm flipping around between MSNBC and, you know, nothing against Ari Melber, but, you know, that wasn't what I needed to see. And then I went over to CNN. I don't know what's going on there. And then I thought, let me see what they're doing on Fox. And Fox was rerunning that shit show live, or not live, but, you know, taped delay. So I watched as much of it as I could and thought, I just can't do this. So I didn't. So what I did was I watched some clips this morning, and oh man, I the ratings were down, by the way, substantially down from 2016 from the RNC, and down from the Democrats convention last week, and down from the first three nights, because people don't want to hear Donald Trump vomit words, because he's got very good words, the best words. So I watched it, and I didn't watch all 70 minutes of it. By the way, this was the second longest nomination acceptance speech in history. Who was the longest, you ask? Well, that was Donald Trump 4 years ago. The man loves the sound of his own voice, loves everything about himself. It's just stunning. So anyway, that's done, although the ramifications will continue. For instance, the House Foreign Affairs Committee today filed an inquiry or a grievance. I'm not sure what the technical thing is, but they did file something against Mike Pompeo for his breaking the rules. Look, no Senate confirmed cabinet member can participate in any kind of political activity. That's why Hillary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, didn't speak at the convention. It's just not done. But Mike Pompeo had no problem with it. In fact, he didn't even speak from D.C., though. He was in the Middle East ostensibly doing, you know, our business, taxpayers' business. And he did this from there. So on so many levels, it was wrong. But then again, everything about that Republican so-called convention was wrong, in that they turned the White House into a rally stage, into a prop for his electioneering. There's a reason you've never seen campaign signs at the White House before, because it just isn't done until Donald Trump, that is. Unbelievable. So we've got a big show for you today. Rick Perlstein is going to be here. Rick Perlstein is a historian and an author. And I, you know, he's one of us. He is definitely a progressive's progressive, but he has dedicated his professional life to telling the story of the rise of the modern conservative movement in this country. I don't know how he does it. I think it would mess with my head too much. But the fourth in the series, and what he says is the final book in the series of this rise of conservatism, is just out. It's called Reaganland. It's a big, thick, almost 1,000-page book. In fact, just the notes at the end could it could be a book on their own. This is, you know, years worth of research, and I'm excited to talk to Rick Perlstein again. So again, he'll be with us at the bottom of the hour. Before we get to that, though, I guess we should talk news. It's interesting. Today is an interesting day. It was how many years ago? 60. What year do I have it written down here? What year this was? Hold on one second. My thing doesn't want to scroll. I hate it when my thing doesn't scroll. You know, I try to save trees by not printing out papers, but sometimes, you know, the computer doesn't play with me. 65 years ago today, yes, it was 65 years ago today that Emmett Till was murdered, young black boy, because he looked at a white woman the wrong way for the white men around him. He looked at her the wrong way, and they killed him, and he suffered a brutal death. And, you know, there's federal anti-lynching legislation that should easily pass, should pass the Congress. It should be a no-brainer. You know who's holding it up? Rand Paul, senator from Kentucky. Now, Rand Paul was at the White House last night for that shit show. And when he left, he was all upset that protesters on the street surrounded him. Now, he said he was assaulted by an angry mob. No such thing happened. Was he yelled at by protesters? Hell yeah. Was he assaulted? No. You know, Rand Paul, you would think he would know what an assault is because he got into it with his neighbor and I guess was really assaulted. But yeah, Emmett Till killed 65 years ago today, 1955. And it was just 8 years later, on this day in 1963, the March on Washington drew more than 200,000 people to the front of the Lincoln Memorial. It's where Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his I Have a Dream speech. I hate to think where he would, you know, what he would be thinking today about what's going on. I can't even imagine. Obviously, I can't put myself in his shoes, but I can't think he'd be very happy with the events of the last couple of years. Certainly, since Donald Trump has taken office. Oh, Donald Trump, who told us again last night that he's done more for black people than any president, except maybe Abraham Lincoln. You gotta be kidding me. Oh, my goodness. So let's get to a little bit of news before we get to Rick Perlstein, shall we? So hit it, boys. That would be this button, I think. No, actually, that would be this button. I read the news today, oh, boy. So Donald Trump formally accepted the Republican Party's nomination on the final night of the Republican convention last night in a live address from the White House. Trump harshly criticized the Democratic presidential nominee, Joe Biden. You know, lying. He lied about everything. I made this mashup for What's News that's playing, you know, throughout the day on the Progressive Voices Network between Daniel Dale on CNN and Rachel Maddow over at MSNBC. Boy, they fact checked him. Here's a little bit of it. I won't subject you to the whole thing, but here's a little bit of Daniel Dale.
This president is a serial liar, and he serially lied tonight. I counted preliminarily more than 20 false or misleading claims. I want to go through a whole bunch of them. Trump said Joe Biden is, quote, talking about taking down the border wall. Biden has specifically, explicitly rejected that idea. He just said he'll stop further additional construction. Trump claimed, as always, that he is the one who passed the Veterans Choice Law. Barack Obama signed that into law in 2014. Trump signed a 2018 law to modify it. Trump said, I have done more for the African-American community than any president since Abraham Lincoln. That is ludicrous. Lyndon Johnson, for one, signed the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. Trump again touted a, quote, record 9 million job gain over the past 3 months. He didn't mention, as usual, that that gain follows a record 22 million job loss over the previous 2 months. He said he'll, quote, continue to lower drug prices. They've increased during his presidency. He said they opened a Jerusalem embassy for less than 500,000. Early documents show it was at least 21 million.
You get the idea, right?
NATO member spending has increased for the first time in about 20 years. Spending, in fact, rose in 2015 and in 2016 before he took office. He said he will always, and Republicans will always, strongly protect people with pre-existing conditions. That pledge has already been broken. Ooh. He and they have repeatedly tried to weaken those protections.
Still
in Obamacare. He claimed again
they go to court November 10th.
Travel from China
Supreme
and
court.
Europe. No, he imposed partial
he
restrictions with many exemptions. Tens of thousands of people continue traveling over. He boasted about the COVID testing system and about his general response. Look, experts near universally say the U.S. was fatally slow in its response, especially slow in setting up adequate testing. He said that he ended what he called a NAFTA nightmare, and he signed a brand new U.S.-Mexico.
You get the idea. This goes on for another 2 minutes. And then Rachel Maddow also went on for about 2.5 minutes, just debunking lies spewed by the president during this interminable monotone speech. It was boring. I mean, it's not like the man doesn't get up in front of a microphone every time possible and spew the same shit all the time. There was nothing new here. It was the same crap, different day. Now, one thing that was in full effect, in full view of the world this past week, was the fact that this convention was filled with Hatch Act violations. Not only last night's disgusting display at the People's House, but Wednesday night's segment, which I mentioned, which Mike Pompeo spoke, unprecedented because it's a political event. So, but interesting how Republicans, well, I guess it's not only a Republican thing. There are a lot of hypocrites in Washington. But right now it's the Republicans in the spotlight. Mark Meadows in 2014 was a congressman. He's now the White House chief of staff, whose responsibility it should be to tell the president, you can't do this. This is a violation of the Hatch Act. And in 2014, Congressman Meadows was very insistent on following the dictates of the Hatch Act, which says that a federal employee, an employee of government, cannot politic, cannot campaign for, cannot go out of their way to influence any election in their official role. And therefore, he insisted that a low-level employee at the FEC in 2014 be fired.
But April Sands recently had to quit the FEC. Why?
Well, she had to quit and resign because she actually violated the Hatch Act, which says that she was actually using a government benefits in terms of actually addressing their political targeting. And it's troubling.
It's troubling, he said. So what did he say yesterday when confronted with the fact that they are violating the Hatch Act?
When you look at official acts and whether it's the naturalization process that went through where you had five new citizens being sworn in or the pardon, there are a couple of things that you can do to make sure that you're in compliance with the Hatch Act. But for the vast majority, and I think, Jake, you may and Anna, you may have pointed that out in Playbook this morning.
He was talking
Nobody
to Politico.
Outside of the Beltway really cares. They expect that Donald Trump is going to promote Republican values.
No, they don't. And people outside the Beltway do care. This is a violation of not only every norm for the past 250 years, but the law. The problem is, who's going to enforce it? I'll tell you who. It won't be until after the fact. If we vote these crooks out of office and the Democrats take over not only the White House, but the Senate and hold on to the House, then they can start holding these crooks accountable. And my goodness, there's a lot of accounting to take care of. It's just sickening. Absolutely sickening. It was nice to see yesterday both Joe Biden and Kamala Harris step up and speak out and get a little forceful, because it seemed like for the first 3 days, they were letting the lies from the Republicans go unchecked. Thankfully, they did speak out yesterday. There's other news going on. Hurricane Laura hit the Louisiana-Texas state line as a powerful Category 4 hurricane with top sustained winds of 150 miles per hour, killing at least six people and leaving billions of dollars of destruction in its wake. Laura weakened to a tropical depression as it pushed inland into Arkansas, with still dangerous winds and rains ahead of a forecast curve east through Kentucky and Tennessee. Forecasters also warned of the possibility of tornadoes in Louisiana, Arkansas, and western Mississippi. And, you know, when you look at some of the devastation around Lake Charles, Louisiana, it's hard to say that they got off easy, that they got lucky, but they did, because the storm hit, I know it's sort of redundant to say, in a swampy, unpopulated part of Louisiana, but more so than the rest of the swampy parts of Louisiana. So thank goodness for very, very small miracles, I guess. Yesterday, I hope you were listening at the beginning of the show when Dave Zirin of The Nation and Edge of Sports joined us. It was good to hear from him, because the sports world is stepping up to make noise and to make a difference. NBA players met yesterday and voted in favor of resuming the basketball playoffs, which were in full swing when the previous day the Milwaukee Bucks decided to boycott their playoff game with the Orlando Magic in order to protest the fatal shooting of Jacob Black by another white police officer. Then two other Wednesday games were postponed, and then other professional sports got in on the action. The WNBA, the National Hockey League, and Major League Baseball all promptly joined the boycott. This may have changed since this morning. I'm not the biggest sports person, so I don't follow that closely. They say no final decision or date for resuming the basketball playoffs has been set, as talks continue among players, coaches, and team owners. Don't take my word for that, though. That could have changed. I don't really know. But as for baseball, something really, I think, cool happened. The New York Mets and the Miami Marlins took the field yesterday at Citi Field in New York. I guess what used to be Shea Stadium. I edited it for time, but here's, you know, what it sounded like in the booth, in the broadcast booth, as the players took the field. They took the field, I think.
And now Lewis Brinson announced as the leadoff hitter for Miami. And all of the Marlins and Mets have come out of their dugouts. Michael Wacha takes off his hat, and all the Mets on the field are removing their hats as well.
Okay. And they're all standing around. I guess this is the unedited version. Oops. Uh-oh. So they had taken the field. The players were on their positions.
A moment of silence that lasted 42 seconds. The day before we celebrate Jackie Robinson Day, the Mets are exiting the field after both teams exchanged a wave of caps to one another. So it would appear as though, after a poignant moment, that the Mets and Marlins will not be playing baseball tonight.
Wow.
And the Black Lives Matter shirts left on top of home plate.
So what happened was the players took the field. I don't know which team was in the outfield and which team was getting ready to go, you know, be up at bat. But the outfield was full. You want to tell me what happened? Jacob Blake. Thank you. So the players took the field. And they were, you know, in position. And then all of a sudden, the remaining players, both on the team that was up at bat and the rest of the players who weren't on, you know, in the field for the other team, all came out of the dugout and they stood on the baselines. I'm trying to use the right vernacular here. And they all took off their hats, or most of them did anyway. And then they stood in silence for 42 seconds to commemorate Jackie Robinson. And then somebody laid a Black Lives Matter t-shirt over home plate and they left the field. And that was that. I think it's awesome. I think it's great. It's a gesture. It's a statement. It's important that we all make these statements right now. It really is. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if they're going to resume play. Again, it's not my usual thing. I don't stay on top of sports, but I think what these athletes are doing is, I don't know how they could do anything else. I really don't. There's one other piece of news that I need to share with you, and it has to do with a story that's in the New York Times today. Peter Baker. I do have another one. But anyway, Peter Baker of the New York Times did an interview, a 40-minute phone interview with Donald Trump. And he said, in the interview, Mr. Trump rattled off a list of what he has done and would continue to do, like increasing military spending, cutting taxes, eliminating regulations, reinforcing the border, and appointing conservative judges. And then, you know, Peter Baker wanted to get from him a question that Trump has been not answering, and that is, what is your second term agenda? And here's the direct quote, as printed in today's New York Times, from the President of the United States. This is unedited. It's the direct quote as read from the paper of record. Quote, Donald Trump speaking here. Again, the question, I know it's a long setup, but the question was your second term priorities. What are you going to do in your second term? And Donald Trump said, quote, but so we would continue what we're doing. We'd solidify what we've done, and we have other things on our plate that we want to get done. Ladies and gentlemen, your President of the United States. Yeah, that's what should have happened last night. All right, let's take some time out and take care of some business on the Progressive Voices Network. We'll be right back. It's Nicole Sandler. Don't go away. And while Progressive Voices is in commercials, I can share something else with you. I guess I could do a funny because we haven't done one. I mentioned this one yesterday. It's a parody song from Founder Sing, who came out of nowhere seemingly with these song parodies. That started with, I think they called themselves Founder Sing because the first one they did was a wonderful animated parody of American Pie sung by the founding fathers. I mean, they had deep fake Lincolns and Washingtons and Jeffersons and Benjamin Franklins and everybody else. So the name was Founder Sing, but now they have all kinds of people singing. And about a month or so ago, they did a takeoff on We Are the World, that they called We Are the Worst. And I guess it went over so well that they did a second part. It's We Are the Worst, the sequel. Take it away, Founder Sing.
Yeah. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and then click on the bell and choose all. That way you'll be notified of every new video.
NicoleSandler.com.
All right. So the founders sing, having fun with We Are the Worst, and they indeed are. I'm so happy to welcome our guest to the program today. Rick Perlstein has been writing about, well, the American right, the conservative movement, for the better part of the last 20 years or so. It's been just about 20 years since he published the book Before the Storm, Barry Goldwater and the Unmasking on the Unmaking of the American Consensus back in 2001. It was the first of four books chronicling the rise and dominance of the conservative movement in American politics. Next up was Nixonland, The Rise of a President and the Fracturing of America, followed by The Invisible Bridge, The Fall of Nixon and the Rise of Reagan, and just out, the fourth and what they say is the final book in the series, Reaganland, America's Right Turn, 1976 to 1980. Rick Perlstein, welcome back to the show.
I've been unmasking all these years, Nicole.
I see. You know, I got to ask you, I know you're as progressive as I am. You've dedicated the last 20 years of your life to the conservatives. Why?
Well, you'd have to ask my shrink that, I think.
I have a bunch of reasons. I got into this, it was 23 years ago when I started writing my book about Barry Goldwater. And I was obsessed with the 1960s. And I would read everything about Abby Hoffman and Tom Hayden and the Black Panthers. And you know, somewhere along the way, I realized that during these years, it was Richard Nixon who won, 49 states in 1972. And you know, Ronald Reagan, won the presidency by kind of campaigning against the 1960s. So I began to think about that period that fascinated me so much, as a civil war between the right and the left. And that became a very productive way of thinking about the forces that produced the political world we were living in when I was writing these books in the 1990s and the 2000s and now the 20-teens. And as I got into the work more and more, I was very gratified to find that it was a useful tool for people who are working to defeat the right. One of the interesting things that happened with my first book about Barry Goldwater was it became kind of a cult favorite, kind of almost a standard text for people who were organizing to nominate Howard Dean in 2004. Hmm. The people who saw this president, saw this political party, the Democrats, that was very moderate and centrist and kind of imitating the other political party. And they saw in what Barry Goldwater's people did in 1964 to try and nominate an ideological candidate in a centrist party as a role, as basically almost like a playbook. And ever since then, I've been very, very gratified to find that people find this work that I've done both kind of comforting in understanding that, we've gotten through worse. They've found it useful and they're strategizing about the right, and they've taken pleasure from it. So it worked out pretty well. I'm really grateful for my readers and grateful for the support I've been able to get.
Well, we're grateful for you because you're telling a story that needs to be told, but I can't imagine that it's always pleasant. I'm sure it's fascinating. Your books are fascinating, but delving into the right wing of American politics for so long, I guess that's why you have a psychologist.
Yeah, I don't anymore. I think I'm better. Okay. But that is where the kind of neurosis comes in. I grew up with parents who, were not necessarily super political people, but they were conservative. Mm. And I would get in arguments with them. My dad was a small businessman and talk about all the regulators who resented him and wanted to put him out of business because they couldn't do what he did. And, my mom would say, why are there so many help wanted? It's why there's so many homeless people when there's so many help wanted ads in the paper. Stuff like that. And I would just argue with them and argue with them. And, you can't win arguments with your parents, right? Because they, they set the rules. And right. That compulsion to try and finally kind of win an argument against my parents, I think, is my compulsion to repeat. And I'm still kind of, even though they're gone, I'm trying to kind of rehearse that thing in my mind and really kind of get it right.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask, if they're still around, if they've been able to read any of your books.
Well, yes, and they, I guess in the end, I would say that I won the argument and that they became big fans of, Rachel Maddow and MSNBC, but I think actually it was George Bush who kind of pushed them.
Interesting.
Pushed them into my camp. Although I have to say, my dad used to bait me. I learned a lot about trolling from having conservative parents. All of us do. He said, when you grow up and you have to make a payroll like me, then you'll put aside these crazy bullshit views. And as soon as my dad retired, of course, and didn't have to make a paywall anymore, although to put it more generously, maybe he could just kind of see the bigger picture without the kind of press of everyday events, he began to realize that, these guys had created a monster. And he was absolutely livid about George Bush. Hmm. And yeah, we became comrades in arms.
Oh, that's nice. Oh, so that's good.
That's a little story.
Happy ending there. It's interesting because your personal life influenced what you did, how you grew up. This book.
Yeah, they all do. Yeah.
This book, Reaganland, effectively ends with the election of Ronald Reagan over Jimmy Carter. It was November 4th, 1980. That was my
11.
You were 11. That was my 21st birthday.
Yeah.
So I turned 21 on the day Ronald Reagan was elected a year earlier on my birthday, November 4th, 1979, the U.S. Embassy in Iran was overrun and the hostages were taken. And my mother had died 10 days earlier. So 10 days before my 20th birthday. So that moment in time about which you're writing is etched in my memory. I mean, those world events. I mean, I remember when the hostages were taken and my mother had just passed away. I'm like, wow, this whole major world event is happening and my mother is not here for it. And, you know, that makes an impact. And so the memory of those dates are still very strong for me, and my whole world certainly changed. And of course, on the day Ronald Reagan was elected, the hostages were miraculously set free, or maybe not so miraculously. So you're writing about a time that, even though it was 40 years ago, is very clear in my mind. So, you know, it's interesting the memories that brings up.
Yeah, I'm really trying to get at the way that political events live in our lives in this very intimate and emotional way. And it's not just, you know, dry stuff that you read about in the paper. I mean, just to talk about that November 4th trauma for a lot of Americans of the hostages being taken. And then the fact that Election Day was a year later.
Yep.
So Election Day, of course, is on a Tuesday, and all the Sunday papers all over the country had these big first anniversary of the hostage being taken stories. Right. So that probably had a big effect on, you know, people going to the polls and, you know, feeling supposedly that America had been humiliated and, you know, voting for the guy who supposedly was going to help us walk tall again. Although there was a joke about after the election, what's green and glows?
Tehran.
Seconds after Reagan's election, right? Which was one of the reasons people were terrified of Ronald Reagan, and I was terrified of Ronald Reagan. You know, when I was, you know, a young adolescent and teenager, we all thought the world might end the next day.
Sure. And, you know, looking back now as someone who was not steeped in history, I wasn't the best student ever, you know, I sort of remember the election being a blowout. But reading your account of it, the polls were actually very close. You say that the Carter people were somewhat overconfident, believing that Jimmy Carter was so much smarter than Ronald Reagan, and all they needed to do was get them on a stage together, and the world would see that Ronald Reagan is an idiot. Carter had the brains. But it sort of backfired on them, because Carter called out Reagan about the fact that he was so anti-Medicare. In fact, I pulled in 1961, Ronald Reagan, who was an actor at the time, was hired by, was it the AMA to
do it? It was the AMA, very right-wing organization then.
Right, to do a recording warning people on the dangers of Medicare and socialism. Here's a little taste of it.
One of the traditional methods of imposing statism or socialism on a people has been by way of medicine. The doctor begins to lose freedoms. It's like telling a lie, and one leads to another. So a doctor decides he wants to practice in one town, and the government has to say to him, you can't live in that town. They already have enough doctors. You have to go someplace else. And from here, it's only a short step to dictating where he will go. All of us can see what happens once you establish the precedent that the government can determine a man's working place and his working methods, determine his employment.
Wow. So this is a guy who was an actor, made great movies like Bedtime for Bonzo. He wasn't exactly an A-list actor. And you even said when he challenged Gerald Ford 4 years earlier for the nomination and lost, that everyone thought he was toast, that he was done. I mean, he was a two-bit actor and he was too old. Right?
Yeah. But
He came
and was responsible for Gerald Ford losing because he refused to campaign for him.
Wow. So, and then all of a sudden he's elevated. He's the Democratic nominee in 1980. The Republican nominee, in 1980. And he's going against the incumbent, Jimmy Carter, who had a rough 4 years. I mean, times were rough from 1976 to 80.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And in that debate, like you said, the Carter people were absolutely convinced that all they needed to do was have a debate and Jimmy Carter would wipe the floor with him because Reagan was a doddering old fool.
Right.
And by the way, Ronald Reagan's closest advisors feared the same thing. They weren't sure they wanted him to debate. And it was only, do you remember, they had this thing in New York every year called the Al Smith Dinner.
And sure, they still do it, I think.
Yeah, they still do it. Mm-hmm. And during presidential years, generally,
both
the
candidates
Republican
speak.
And Democratic nominees come, right? Yep. And it's kind of like a roast. They kind of make fun of each other and they tell jokes. And, you know, it's this lovely little bipartisan, you know, kind of ritual and shows that we all love each other. And, you know, out on election day, tanks don't run through the streets, yada, yada, yada. And Jimmy Carter did what he always did. He kind of gave this kind of, you know, kind of school marmish, dry, kind of hard shell Baptist kind of lecture to the crowd. And Ronald Reagan did what he'd been doing for, you know, basically 30 years by that point. He told this incredibly charming, he did this, you know, charming joke-like presentation.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's when his aides are like, this guy is ready to go. We're going to put him in this debate. And what both the Carter people and the Reagan people had kind of forgotten was that Reagan had never lost a debate in his entire life, because he was, you know, so slippery and so willing to, you know, kind of shade the truth. And he had that charming grin. So the debate comes, and they negotiated. The Carter people very carefully negotiated as much possible as they could for rebuttals, because they thought, oh, if just Jimmy Carter can just explain patiently where Ronald Reagan is wrong and what facts he's fudging, then he'll win. And of course, you know, no one likes a pedant. No one likes someone who, you know, like lectures them about how wrong they are. And Jimmy Carter came off looking really, really kind of irritating. And
I have the clip. So here it is from that debate. And this is perhaps where the entire election changed or was decided.
What happened behind the scenes?
Well,
tell you what happened behind the scenes after you play the clip.
Okay, got it. All right, so here's the clip.
You run the clip now?
I'm going to run the clip right now. Here we go.
Okay.
Governor Reagan, as a matter of fact, began his political career campaigning around this nation against Medicare. Now we have an opportunity to move toward national health insurance with an emphasis on the prevention of disease, an emphasis on outpatient care, not inpatient care. An emphasis on hospital cost containment to hold down the cost of hospital care for those who are ill. An emphasis on catastrophic health insurance, so that if a family is threatened with being wiped out economically because of a very high medical bill, then the insurance would help pay for it. These are the kind of elements of a national health insurance important to the American people. Governor Reagan, again, typically is against such a proposal.
Governor, there you go again. When I opposed Medicare, there was another piece of legislation meeting the same problem before the Congress. I happened to favor the other piece of legislation and thought that it would be better for the senior citizens and provide better care than the one that was finally passed. I was not opposing the principle of providing care for them. I was opposing one piece of legislation as versus another.
Governor Reagan, as a matter of fact, began his political...
Hold on, there's Jimmy Carter. Hey, Rick, I seem to have lost your video.
Oh, I just decided to take it off so there would be bandwidth.
We're
on video,
gotcha.
Too.
Oh, yes, we're on video, too. Hold on 1 second. Let me put you back up. There you are. Yay.
Hi. I would have gone to my studio.
No, that's fine.
Okay, so here's the thing. So you perfectly set it up so your listeners know he's lying.
Yes.
Right, he's saying up is down, 2 + 2 = 5, right?
Yep.
And after that happened, right, backstage, Henrik Hertzberg, the great writer who was a Jimmy Carter speechwriter at the time, told me they were all high-fiving each other. He'd fallen right into their trap.
Mm-hmm.
Because next morning, the headlines would be, Ronald Reagan lies about his record. The headlines were not Ronald Reagan lies about a record. It was Ronald Reagan charms the nation and Jimmy Carter... sounds like a boring old
Jimmy
ass.
Carter's mean.
There
you go again. The line, there you go again. There you go again, what? Pointing out fact?
Well, it was in the context of the speech, of the debate, Ronald Reagan, Jimmy Carter had said something very similar about Ronald Reagan having opposed Social Security, and he lied about that too. So there you go again was his way of saying, I just explained to you that you're destroying my record, and there you go again. This is what you do. You're an asshole.
Wow.
Am I allowed to say that?
Yes, you're allowed to say anything you want here. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So the press gave Reagan a pass. They thought they were charmed. There you go again. Oh, how clever. And you even heard the crowd laugh. But the press, instead of looking into what Carter said about the truth about Reagan, who did oppose Medicare, it wasn't about one piece of legislation. He opposed Medicare. He was calling it socialism. Be very scared.
If it passes, Yeah, if it passes, we're going to be telling our children stories about what America was like when it was free.
That's right. But instead, the press went on.
Not exactly favoring one piece of legislation over another.
No, not at all. Yeah. And instead, the press goes on to berate Carter over his brother.
Yeah.
Because he had a brother, Billy.
Right. And that's a big, 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 big part of the story of that I tell in Reaganland, exactly. That Billy Carter was this kind of goofball that everyone remembers if they're of a certain age, who, mm-hmm. you know, basically embarrassed himself in front of the press all the time, did belly flops for the camera, you know, would sit on his ratty couch in his gas station and drink beer and get drunk
Billy
and
beer.
Tell funny stories about his brother, mm-hmm. right? He was the classic embarrassing brother, you know, like Roger Clinton or Hillary Clinton
That's
had
right.
one too, right?
Yeah.
Except for it got a little serious when he traveled to Libya, which was sponsoring terrorism, mm-hmm. and took a $200,000 quote-unquote loan, interest-free with no paperwork, and promised them that he would try and influence his brother. Very serious stuff. And it was investigated. But the way it was investigated was reported basically as kind of the butthurt emails of 1980.
Right.
The New York Times did 50 stories about this in 1 month, even though there was never a single thing done in the White House that was illegal or unethical. And at the same time, Ronald Reagan, you know, is, you know, lying about Social Security, lying about Medicare. The New York Times didn't cover that at all. And they also slighted a story of one of Ronald Reagan's aides, his main foreign policy aide, who was on the take from, you know, a fascist government of Portugal, you know, who had, you know, sold influence during the Nixon administration. His name was Richard V. Allen. He lasted as the national security advisor for like 6 months before he was kicked out for corruption. And the media just decided they had to bend over backwards to be, quote unquote, fair to both sides, which, of course, is a way of being biased towards the Republicans.
Of
because
course.
If the Republicans are willing to lie and you transmit the lie, you're biased.
So some things never change. I mean, when I started doing, you know, my preparation for this interview, I'm thinking, okay, so what does Donald Trump have in common with Ronald Reagan, other than the fact that both of them are certainly not progressive? I wouldn't necessarily say Donald Trump is conservative. I don't know what he is. I don't think he's got any ideology except the almighty dollar and what's good for him and his family. But they both play other people. They both make shit up. And Carter calling Reagan out on lying got him in trouble. There's so many parallels that now they're just sort of hitting me over the head. Ronald Reagan was a liar, was he not? Oh, I think Rick is frozen.
There are parallels. Oh, no.
Yeah. Sorry, we're buffering here a little bit.
Are you good?
Yeah, okay. There we go, I think. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Buffering. Ronald Reagan did it all with a smile, and Donald Trump did it with a scowl.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
But another, you know, Reagan did have some saving graces. You know, he was very generous towards immigrants, right? He loved the idea that immigrants
wanted
to come to
this
country.
Yep.
And him and George Bush kind of competed with each other during the Texas primary in 1980 to see who could say the nicest things about not just Mexican immigrants, but undocumented Mexican immigrants, right? But at the same time, is it better or worse when you have a guy who can present policies that are, you know, equally terrible for the vulnerable populations of America and persuade people that you're not scary when you do it, right? Although, to be fair, Ronald Reagan basically pretty much, with a lot of exceptions, turned over the governing of the country to experts, right? They were conservative experts, and they were experts who were, you know, trying to lower taxes for the rich and lower services for the poor. But, you know, they were pretty much kind of doing things on a professional level, except there were all these, you know, little pockets of insanity in the Reagan administration. Like, you remember James Watt.
Oh, yeah.
You know, who was basically the
interior secretary, right?
Who didn't think the government should own any public lands. Mm-hmm. You know, greatest hits of the Reagan administration. There were, of course, these lunatics down in the basement of the White House who were defying Congress, laws passed by Congress, and secretly passing on aids to the death squads in Central America,
right.
You know, and the money they were raising by selling missile parts to Iran to try and get back hostages. And then after Iran got the money, they would take another hostage, right? So what you have is everything is really an embryo for the fully hatched monster of Donald Trump. Trump is inconceivable without what happened during the period of his book. And by the way, when you talk about Jerry Falwell Jr., there's nothing Jerry Falwell Jr. is up to that you can't see Jerry Falwell Sr. doing.
Right, and Jerry Falwell Sr. was right in the thick of this. This was the beginning.
And he was extremely close to Ronald Reagan. I have a picture of him practically kissing Ronald Reagan in the book.
Yeah, you do have pictures in the book.
The nastiness of someone like Jerry Falwell towards gays and lesbians, literally claiming that they were recruiting children in order to murder them, kind of that the QAnon of 1979,
right,
is you know, unparalleled by, you know, anyone on the right today. So the idea that we had some kind of right wing innocence before and it went crazy now, that doesn't really fly either. So
no,
it's not a simple black and white thing. We have continuity and change. And that's why the book is 900 pages.
It is 900 and some odd pages.
A pamphlet.
And then, as I was saying earlier, even the notes at the end could be a book on their own. Rick Perlstein is with us. We're talking about his newest book, Reaganland, America's Right Turn, 1976 to 1980. So you say this is the fourth and final book in the series, but obviously conservatism didn't end with Ronald Reagan. It just it almost exploded. I mean, 1980 was when Paul Weyrich, who the Heritage Foundation, and I think he's one of the founders of ALEC. I have a clip that I play all the time, especially right now.
You play his famous speech at that was the rally with Jerry Falwell, where Ronald Reagan said, "You may not be able to endorse me, but I endorse you." So in other words, he's hugging to his breast Jerry Falwell. This is the same rally where Paul Weyrich says we don't want people to vote.
Exactly. Good government syndrome. We don't want people to vote. The more people that vote, the worse it is for us. And they play the long game. I've been saying this for years. They have been working on this strategy to keep us from voting since then. Democrats, on the other hand, say, you know, we've been working for voting rights, but not as, I think, clear-headed, not as single-minded, focused on the outcome.
They try and sabotage the institutions at the foundation of liberalism.
Hmm. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
Sabotage the universities, sabotage the liberal churches, sabotage the labor unions, right? We do elections every 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
But luckily, we have great movements that, you know, sometimes break out into the mainstream of the Democratic Party. I mean, if you look at the long game, look at the Black Lives Matter movement in its modern form really starts with Fruitvale Station. You know, it starts with Oscar Grant being murdered by the California Transit Police in, you know, 2008, mm-hmm. right? And you have this movement that has carefully built up this case about what the police are about. And now we're finally beginning to see it bear fruit 12 years later. I mean, what they've accomplished is amazing. In 2015, only half of Americans believe racism was a serious problem. In the latest polls, it's 76%. And that's because of a movement that's done exactly what you said, played the long game.
There was also a lot of other forces at work. We mentioned, you know, Jerry Falwell. This was the rise of the moral majority, the religious right. There was also the women's movement happening, and, you know, Gloria Steinem rising and Phyllis Schlafly trying to shut them down. So all this was coming together at the same time.
All these women entering politics for the first time, because a lot of these Christians didn't believe in electoral politics. That was dirty stuff. That was not, you know, there's a line in Thessalonians in the Bible that says, keep your eyes trained on that which is above, you know. But then they said, wow, destroy the liberal sinners. We're all going to be, men are going to be wearing dresses. And some of the language is absolutely crazy. They were absolutely obsessed with the idea that the government was going to force schools to hire homosexual teachers.
Oh, my God. Oh, wow. Wow. So all this.
And then there's the corporate thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And then something else I didn't realize, because I always thought that Jimmy Carter was pretty liberal, but you wrote that Carter had a passion for austerity. He said the necessity for government to retreat from its post-New Deal role in helping America build and maintain the middle class. And then he was for deregulation.
Very big on deregulation. Yeah. You like my hat?
Very nice.
He had a press availability once where he had a stack of paper 2 feet high, and he claimed that that was all the regulations that he cut from the books, workplace regulations, OSHA regulations, right? It was very fashionable those days among, you know, there was a magazine called Washington Monthly, which does great stuff now, but the idea was somehow the New Deal tradition had become an old and stale and kind of ossified and was kind of destroying America's dynamism. The tragedy of this is that it was happening at the same time as American incomes are beginning to stagnate. Jimmy Carter had a lot of liberal qualities, right? He was absolutely committed to the Equal Rights Amendment. He brought a kind of idealism to foreign policy that we hadn't seen in generations. For example, one of his great accomplishments was signing and getting the Senate to pass a treaty that turned the Panama Canal over to the Panamanians. Yeah. It was really kind of a de-accession of American colonialism. He tried valiantly to get a strategic arms limitation treaty passed with the Soviet Union, but the conservatives, you know, sabotaged that. So it's a mixed record, but the real tragedy is he set the tone for a generation of Democrats to retreat from economic liberalism. And
we're buffering again. Oh, this is killing me that our connection is doing this. We're speaking with Rick Perlstein. Hopefully the internet logjam will clear up in a second, and we can finish this discussion. We're going to have to reconvene on another day because we're getting close to the end of the hour. And I think, are you back? No. Rick Perlstein, I think I've lost you because we got no audio now. I see you. You want to try to kill your video again and see if that helps clear it up? I think we totally lost him. I am so bummed. Rick Perlstein is our guest. The book is Reaganland, America's Right Turn, 1976 to 1980. Oops. And now, now he's totally gone. So we've lost his connection entirely. Well, we'll see if he reconnects. If he doesn't, I will book Rick for another appearance because we still have a lot to talk about. For instance, the whole thing about, you know, the religious right. What's so weird is Jimmy Carter was actually the first evangelical president, and Ronald Reagan was not, but yet the evangelicals embraced Reagan over Carter. You know, there are so many parallels today. And as I keep saying, you know, the old, song, and I know Rick is a big jazz fan, so I'm guessing he might know Shirley Bassey's singing on a song called "History Repeating" with the Propellerheads. That's what I think of with this today. We lost Rick, so all right. So that's gonna end the interview. We're coming on the end of the hour anyway. I will rebook him, but let me just tell you, it's intimidating. A book this big is really it's over 900 pages for the book proper, and then it gets into notes and things. But it is fascinating, and Rick Perlstein is one of our best writers. There are all kinds of excerpts out because the book has just been out about a week or so. So do check it out. Again, it's called Reaganland. And with that, we come to the end of another week, such as it was. Well, now the convention's over, and it's on to the general election. And boy, do we have our work cut out for us. And I'll tell you, after the convention, even though last night was such a shit show, it's probably going to tighten. The polls will tighten. The right is making a hero out of this kid who murdered protesters in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Things are going to get a whole lot uglier. We need to stay firm. We need to do all we can. Now we're hearing all these sports teams are making their arenas available for massive voting centers for the elections. So there will be plenty of machines and plenty of room for people to vote and keep their social distance and be safe about it. We need to turn out like we've never turned out before because the future of our world is at stake. Big thanks to Rick Perlman for helping us wrap up the week. I'm so sorry about the connection. The internet can't live with it. Can't live without it. All right. With that, have a great weekend, everyone. I will see you Monday. And we'll be back here Monday. Take care. Be safe. Bye.